Welcome, everyone. My name is Dr. Laura Cohen, and I'm the executive of the Harriet and Kenneth Kupferberg Holocaust Center at Queensborough Community College at the City University of New York. Our mission is to use the lessons of the Holocaust to educate current and future generations about the ramifications of prejudice, racism, and stereotyping. Today's event is the first of two, entitled Peacebuilding Through Awareness and Improvisation, and comes out of a workshop on empathy to action, which CUNY students developed in partnership with the Kupferberg Holocaust Center in 2019. It's co-sponsored by Transformative Learning in the Humanities at the City of New York, the QCC Mindfulness Club and Office of Student Activities Thrive Series, and QCC's Visual and Performing Arts Academy. The Kupferberg Holocaust Center in Bayside, New York, is situated on the traditional land of the Manteenikok people, who continue to live here today. We offer gratitude and respect to all of the indigenous people of Turtle Island, past, present, and future, including the Lenape and Shinnecock people. What I just read is what we call a land acknowledgement. This is a statement recognizing that the land we all occupy in the course of our daily lives, including our schools, jobs, parks, and homes, as well as the names of towns and roads, belonged to another group of people who were forcibly expelled and murdered. Today, we identify those crimes for what they are: mass atrocities and genocide. These horrors continue to have a devastating political, social, psychological, and economic impact upon and within Native American and Indigenous communities. Now, shifting gears. After the presentation and during today's presentation, please submit your questions via the Q&A feature on your screen. Today's facilitators are Awana Hayashi, creator of Social Presencing Theater, and Uri Noy Meir, an artist facilitator co-creating social art across borders. CUNY faculty members Heather Huggins, advanced practitioner of SPT and assistant professor of theater, and Aviva Geismar, associate professor of dance. Also being a number of QCC's student and alumni practice group from the Global Citizenship Alliance. Today, more than anything, is about listening to the body, thinking of how to process feelings around complicated issues, and finding community through peace building and empathy. One of the things this group taught me is in work that I do in atrocity sites and visiting places of real pain and horror around the world, how I can listen to my body more and find community with other people, not just through talking, but for listening in. So we'd like to start today with you can hear more from our alumni of the QCC Global Citizenship Alliance. Be well.
Hello, my name is Jessica Chrysler. The year I participated in the Global Citizenship Alliance was in 2018. I just recently joined SPT, but I was introduced to it about 2 years ago, right after I came back from GCA.
Hi, my name is Joseph Distel, and I was a participant in the Global Citizenship Alliance in the spring of 2017. And I was introduced to SPT a year later by Heather Huggins in the spring of 2018.
My name is Yineng Yi. I'm a theater practitioner. I went to the Global Citizenship Seminar, aka GCA, in 2016. In a seminar in Salzburg, Austria, there's something I learned that was rarely found in traditional classroom. The difference between sympathy and empathy is action. Not only that, empathy calls for action. Empathy is an action. This has become clearer to me since I started practicing social presencing theater, SPT, in 2018.
While we were in Austria, we talked a lot about empathy, and while I understood what empathy meant, it was a really difficult space for me to access because it made me feel very vulnerable and uncomfortable having these conversations.
We did all of our courses because to do this you have to go through all these courses, which is like empathy to action and understanding gentrification and humanity as a whole. After landing in Austria, I felt a strong connection and I couldn't figure out exactly what that connection was to me. Being that I am Jewish, I did grow up with customs, but I never really clicked, and I never really felt Jewish in a way. I always felt like it was something that I grew up with and it was regular for me, but it was never something that really stood out to me. So after going and having the courses that we have over there, we took a trip, and the trip was to Dachau, which is a concentration camp. Going to Dachau was such a heartbreaking experience for me, and I have never felt so connected to anything in my life. I had never felt so sad. I've been to Dachau before when I was in high school. I went once and I had a similar experience, but it was never so connected like this. And I think it's because of GCA that I felt this way, because I was able to understand what these feelings were, and I was able to understand that I did have empathy for my ancestors and for the people that did go through this.
Being in Salzburg, being outside of the United States, and being a foreigner, such an alienating experience made me realize what happened to refugees and other less fortunate people in the world could happen to me or any one of us. In SPT, through simple body movements that are connected to mindfulness practice, I rediscover my body's connections to the mind, the earth, and the social fabric that weave our daily life. And in return, these connections amplify empathy, which is a source of incubating changes.
It wasn't until a year later, when I was introduced to SPT, that I understood that these were now going to be the tools that I could use to access that space of empathy. That SPT allowed me to go deep enough to empathize with another person and communicate across boundaries of language and identity and speak to each other as human beings using our bodies. 2 years after I was introduced to SPT, Heather, Yi, and I had the fortune of going back to the Global Citizenship Alliance and creating a workshop. It was a very full circle, surreal moment for me, being able to be in that room that I was once a participant and student in, to now be an instructor and leader of this workshop. At the end of the workshop, we had prepared a hybrid version of some of the SPT practices, in which everyone was in a circle and we were able to offer some sort of gesture or saying or phrase as reflection for the entirety of the workshop. Before the practice started, I centered myself and I spoke to this group of people that I had never met before that day. And it wasn't until then that I had realized that without SPT and without the Global Citizenship Alliance, I would have never been able to put myself in the center of that circle. I would have never been able to put myself at the center of an issue and be able to empathize with a group of people and be able to talk about things like empathy and change and what we can do to create change from the community level and not just people giving legislation on what change should be. I was able to put myself in the center and look at this group of people and feel what they were feeling, and explain to them that no matter how big or small their offer was, it still was valid and meant something to the group. And for me, that's where the two connect, that they allowed me to realize that no matter how big or small the change that we were able to create in the world, it's still change. It still comes from a place of empathy. It still allows us to be the most authentic versions of ourselves and communicate with people and realize at the end of the day, no matter what we identify as, we're all just human.
After coming back from GCA, I was introduced by Heather Huggins to SPT, which I didn't understand, social presencing. I was like, what does that mean? And little did I know that the two connected. There was never a specific time that I felt that they connected, rather than it was an experience in a whole, in a way to just be able to move your body and experience life and yourself transforming and the truth in that there is no judgment. You are who you are at the end of the day, and just to feel empathy for yourself. I think it's so important, and that we forget all the time that we are just humans living on this earth, and as much as we have a purpose, we also need to live and to experience and not hold back so much. We can't hold back all of our trauma. You need a way to express it, and I feel that SPT was the best way to do it. I'm still in the process of understanding SPT, but I also am freeing up my soul and understanding my truth.
The practices of SPT are small steps. Yet, imagine if we repeat these small steps every day, we will go a long way in bringing changes. I look forward to practicing with you.
Thank you so much, Laura, and thank you to the KHC for having us this morning, as well as supporting all of us. What I'd like to do right now is invite the woman who brought students such as myself together with her experience and learnings of SPT, making it possible for us to share with you today. Heather Huggins.
Thank you so much, Jess. It is so incredible to be here together to share about our experiences with SPT. My name is Heather Huggins, and I'm an assistant professor of theater here at QCC. And I had the fortune to participate in one of the social presencing theater advanced training programs, where I was able to learn with Arawana Hayashi, Manish Srivastava, and Kate Johnson. And during that year-long training program, each participant was invited to collaborate with a small group to create a prototype in their context. And when that arrived for me, I was experiencing a challenge in my own work context as an educator, where I was seeing students flourishing in the classroom, and then when I would see them in other contexts, maybe even on our own campus, I would see somehow their authenticity dissolving because they were faced with challenges around identity and power and privilege. And so we have a word that we use in social presencing theater to even describe this feeling, something we'll do together today with Arawana, which is stuck. So this was a deep stuck in my being. And so for my prototype, in April 2018, I invited a few students and alumni to explore how SPT might support all of us. And that group included Joe and Yi, who you've already heard from. It also included Gio, who you'll see here today. And we have continued from that small gathering to welcome other people. So also here today are Lewis and Chris and Justin and Jess, and Aviva Geismar, an associate professor of dance, is here helping behind the scenes. So 3 years later, from having that initial activity, our group has continued to grow. We come and go as we are able. For example, today he shared that video with us because he's currently serving in the National Guard. Our group continues to practice together as an ensemble. We co-create performances. Students present their action research findings as undergraduate research. In 2019, a group presented at CUNY's Faculty Diversity and Inclusion Conference. And then a few students also presented their own work at QCC's Undergraduate Research Day. This moment holds so much significance for us. For me, because it's an opportunity to keep hearing from the students. And I think that's what I really want to clarify about what we're going to be discussing, is that this offering on peace building through awareness and improvisation, it emerged from Joe and Yi's insights, thinking about their experience with GCA and also thinking about SPT. They brought that idea to us, and then the group supported, and we found partners all across campus to help us. Today is also just a precious gift, a kind of encounter, because we get to invite two guests to the KHC, Arawana Hayashi and Uri Neumeyer. And we're so happy that they're both here to help us in continuing this conversation. Finally, I just want to acknowledge that, like, we're still living in this pandemic. And so across the globe and in our own community, our lives have been deeply impacted. And this reality has just deepened our intention to share about the work, to find ways to come together. Also, we used to do this in person, but we've decided it's worth doing on Zoom. We've decided it's worth finding other ways to connect in this way. And, you know, today might be a little bit messy because we're doing some things through technology. So for us, we're inviting you to kind of join in another empathy to action journey. And we're so, so excited that you're here and joining in to participate with us. So now I really want to invite Felicia Lewis, who's crafted a poem that she's going to share with us about our group.
Thank you, Heather. You and me and him and her and they and everyone on this moving body and in this human body, broken up by titles, places, the features on our faces, but intertwined by the moment, this moment, and moments in between that humanly join you and me and him and her and they and everyone. Turn off that inhumanly human side, that part of us bent by the need to survive that strains and drains itself even with breath. Allow us the time out of your day and grant yourself the right to rest and be. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Lewis. We would just like to remind everyone that this is a space where you can share and be heard. We invite you to join these practices, but of course, only to your comfortability, whether that means participating or just observing and reflecting today. Of course, understanding the world and wherever we may be on it during these times. Everything and everyone are welcomed as our intentions are integrated practice for everyday life, and we only ever wish to support you.
And now it's my great honor to invite Arowana Hayashi to share with us. Arowana is an artist, an educator, she's an author. She's one of the creators of social presencing theater. We're so happy to welcome her here to share these practices with us this morning.
Hey there. Thank you. Thank you so much. And for all of the students, such a beautiful and moving journey. And also, of course, to Laura and to the Holocaust Center for hosting this event today. And also my gratitude to those who've joined in to share in this celebration, who've taken the time to join us. I'd like to just say how in a way, how extraordinary this work is, that this social presencing theater, which has been referred to by its initials, SPT, social presencing theater was developed really under the umbrella of the Presencing Institute, which is a network of people on the planet who really want to bring an awareness-based change, who want to create a good organizations, good communities, a good society, and acknowledge that this requires a certain kind of awareness, that it's self-awareness, being able to be reflective about our own choices that we make. It extends to awareness of others, what we call our social field, our social relationships, our social bodies, all of the groups that we live and work in. Awareness of the planet itself, the health of our planet and all beings. And then we could say awareness of what is about to happen, or the language of presencing is our emerging future, that we can be present in this very moment to possibility that is completely open and fresh not just a habitual repetition, but if we actually have some stillness and some presence and awareness, we're able to access our real creativity, our innovation in terms of creating a good social reality, good social systems. It's being able to see the wisdom in each of us, the basic goodness, basic kindness and strength and wisdom that we all have, and that was so evident in this video with everyone sharing of how they're able to access their own empathy, their own humanity, and then be able to express that in some way. Like Heather and like many of these students, my background is in the theater, particularly in dance and in movement. And my entire life has been there. And then when I joined my life with the Presencing Institute, the work became more specific around social issues, or it could be environmental or organizational for that matter. And one of our areas has been education, that how to co-create inclusive and innovative education in the way that this program has been. And I mentioned before with our small group that I feel this work that Heather and the students have done can be a real model for other universities, other campuses that could be interested in awareness and in this embodied knowing. So my part of the program is largely around inviting you in your own spaces to participate a little bit in the practices that we're referring to, that the students are referring to. And when we hear, for instance, the poem we heard, that it just comes out of such a freshness and an open view. So that much of our practice is around these two themes of the session. One is awareness and one is innovation. And so we would like to offer some practices. And then Heather has invited one of our wonderful colleagues, Uri, who will also speak a little bit more about social art. So if we could begin, and as Jess said, just I know everyone has their own kind of spaces, and some of us have children at home and or we're in other kinds of spaces that might not be so conducive to a little stillness. But nonetheless, we'd like to offer that and see how people could join in if you can. We always start with this sense of embodied presence, living in the body, with a full recognition that most of us think a lot. We think of the past, we remember things, and we project into the future our own fears and worries. We play over and over stories of the past, both personal and cultural, historic. And all these stories have their place. And yet in our work, we're not so interested in the story. We're not so interested in the sort of frameworks, the conceptual frameworks. As was said in the video, we are interested in this loyalty to the body, to the feeling, sensing body. So when I say feeling, I don't mean just emotions, but I mean this felt sense, the knowing that we all have that is not just conceptual knowing, but this felt sense we have about one another, the felt sense we have about spaces, about situations. We have a feeling. Sometimes people might call that a gut feeling, or a like a heartfelt the feeling. If you say, I don't quite know why, but I have this sense or this feeling about something. And our work cultivates that kind of intelligence, that kind of knowing. And it starts with just a little bit of sitting still. And I'm going to invite us into this, if you don't mind, just to be able to take a moment and be present. It's kind of landing. It means landing in a spot, letting go of what you think as much as you can. And the way we do that is by feeling the body. And I'm going to ask you to sit up in your chair and feel your feet on the floor so that you feel grounded and attached to this earth. You really feel those feet. You feel that seat where you're sitting. You feel that you have a place on the land, on this land where you live or where you're sitting. You have a place there. Every single being on the planet has a place right now where they're standing or sitting or lying down. And we can feel that we belong there. This spot that I'm sitting in right now, the spot that each of you is sitting, there's a sense that we belong in this place, that the Mother Earth body is welcoming us, is holding us. Take a moment to feel that, which means really just feeling your lower body and feeling that it has a connection to the earth. It belongs on the earth. You have a strong back. You can feel our ancestors and our teachers and our mentors and so many women, men, binary people on the planet before us who have really contributed to making a good world. We feel their strength. We feel that they're cheering us on. We feel it in our back. We feel the top of our head to the open sky, vast, without any limits. Anything is possible. And we feel our heart. Both a joyful appreciation for being able to be with each other right now, appreciation for our experiences, our family and friends, our health. And also we feel the brokenheartedness, the sadness, the sorrow. For so much suffering, injustice, cruelty, stupidity. So the heart feels all of this, the richness of being a human being. And that heart is not just a little closed box, right? The heart radiates. To the backsides and fronts, it radiates our human goodness. So we always start our practices with this little touch-in of our embodied presence. It's a check-in. How is my body right now? How do I feel right now? Now I'm going to ask you to alternate a little bit. You have this is a still shape. It's what we call a sculpture, a still shape. Please add now a little movement. Just do whatever your body feels like. Don't think about it. You don't need to be thinking at all. You can have your eyes closed. Just what does the body feel like doing? Does it feel like stretching or bending or shaking or jiggling? Or what does it feel like doing? And Exactly. And then please come to a still shape. What does that shape feel like? And what does that shape feel like doing? Okay, so begin that movement. Moving. You can be in your chair, but you can also stand up, or if we were in a studio, we would be able to lie down and sit on the floor. That might be possible and it might not. And now come to a still shape, resting. Once more, what does this shape want to do now? Moving, 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 and stop. Still shape. So just do this for another minute on your own. So you don't need to be looking at the screen or anything. Just what would you do on your own? Just moving, shape, and then still. And again, if you want to move out of your chair, that would be just great. Engaging a little more of your body in the activity. Sometimes people do like, we often do like to start lying down, but in this case, we just do whatever could be workable for you. Just what is it that your body wants to do? You're being loyal to, faithful to the feeling of the body. The body's language is feeling, right? And if you have thoughts about that, you can just let that go. We're not paying attention to our thoughts right now. We're paying attention to how do those fingers feel? What about shoulders? How are they this morning or today? What about legs? Legs have something to say about the day. Good. Now let your body just come to a still shape. Can be standing or sitting, just a still shape. And really pay attention to the back of the body. So you feel that your body is a 360 degree person, not just a front. Even though we have all this looking at the screen, it's very important to feel the back of the body is present. The eyes are relaxed. And just rest. Very good. Okay. Perfect. Now, you can, let's just take a little bit of a moment here and have a little bit of reflection. If you have something that you'd like to write in the chat, you can, but I was going to also ask some of our colleagues here, maybe Gio or Jess, if they would like to say something or reflect at all about this sense of embodiment and awareness of the body. Please feel free if you have a moment to reflect. Did anything come to your mind that you noticed? If your body had a little message for you, what would that be? What was your body saying to you? And then certainly you can reflect by saying, I noticed this, or I felt this. And any of us who are practicing together here, please feel free to share something if you'd like.
I feel curious and open.
Aviva says, I felt tired and noticed movement felt good.
Upon starting to move, I noticed that there was stiffness in my body and through the movements I was doing, I was able to like loosen those muscles and be able to stretch, because that's also something you don't really think about doing, is stretching every day. Mm-hmm. And to like take this opportunity to check in with my body and realize that was, my body was telling me, yes, you need to stretch out because you've been sitting here all day, was a great experience that typically I wouldn't go through.
Great. It only takes a few minutes to just be kind to our bodies, huh? Thank you.
Jody shares that she felt spontaneous emotional release when we began focusing on our feet.
I noticed that I first started out very open, and as I actually started to get up, I started to kind of clutch onto my body a little bit. And once I told myself to just kind of relax and just untangle those tense muscles, I really just started to kind of flow with whatever shape I was doing.
Beautiful.
Allison shares, this is so helpful. As an educator, I notice so much stiffness from working remotely. I noticed my body wanted to stretch and then smile.
Beautiful. Yeah, we forget just to do simple things, you know. Some people have more discipline around a body practice, but it's good to have something that's just, this, you don't have to do it right, and you know, doesn't, you don't have to go anywhere to do it. It's just a simple thing we can do to bring this intelligence and wisdom of the body into our awareness, yeah. Anything else?
Kathy shares that she felt increasingly fluidity, freedom of listening deeply to my body and letting go to whatever wanted to happen and letting that be and emerge.
Yeah, it's perfectly all right sometimes if we just also feel, you know, sometimes we feel an unwanted feeling that we use our thinking to keep feelings away, you know, to press feeling down. And so sometimes I might, in my, we call this practice a 20-minute dance, and this is what the Heather's students have been doing also. And it, you know, you can do it for quite a long time, as I said, starting on the floor and working our way up to standing. But sometimes I just contact a kind of sadness. I didn't even realize I felt sad. And suddenly I lie down on the floor and I begin my embodiment. And I just notice how I'm carrying in my being something that I didn't even, or wasn't even aware of. And therefore it gives the body and the mind an opportunity to integrate and to synchronize. So that's really, this is called a mindfulness practice, where you attend to the detail of your experience, sitting, moving, can be your breathing or something like that. That's called mindfulness practice, and mindfulness and awareness are the basis of the work that we do. I wanted to add one more thing, if I may, and with the help of a couple of our friends here, to apply this to something. Now, here's how it goes, and I'm going to ask you to stand up if you will. If you don't want to, that's fine. Just do it in the chair, but it's better if you can stand for this one. And I'm going to say, everybody's life, everybody's work has places, as Heather said, that are sort of stuck. They're not moving forward. Now, we don't regard this as a problem. We just regard that as a natural process, a natural part of any creative process, of any innovation or change process. There's always obstacles, stuck places. And these, we say, this is great. I have a stuck. We don't try to get rid of those or feel shame and pretend that they're not happening or dwell on them about how, you know, you know how we don't know what we're doing. We just say, oh, this is a stuck. And there are forces that are keeping me stuck. Some of them are internal, you know, my lack of confidence or something. Some of them are external. We don't have enough funding. We are not in the right team. You know, a variety of things could be making us feel that we can't move forward. Now, I'm going to ask a few of us to make these stucks together. So you have to have a stuck in order to do it. You have to have something that you can think of, some relationship or something that's not, it's a little obstacle to moving forward. You're trying to create something, you know, a good team or a project, but you've got a little stuck. So what does the stuck feel like? What is it that you were not, this is not psychodrama, so you're not acting it out. Now, psychodrama is wonderful work, I'm certain, but that's not exactly what we're doing here. We're saying that nobody's stuck by themselves. There are forces that keep us stuck. In a systems approach, there's no such thing as being, you know, it's just me, because there's lots of other forces, right? Now, are those forces pushing you down? Do you feel that way? Or do you feel that you're trying to go forward, but the forces are holding you back? It's just like somebody's pulling you from the back? Or are the forces stretching you in different directions? Or, you know, do you have conflicting loyalties, work and family, or something like that? Or sort of what could you, if you think about your stuck and the forces, what kind of shape would you make in the body? So just everybody try this together. Just get up and give it a try. You're stuck, just think about it for a moment. What does it feel like? Try to get a sense of that. Some aspect of that. And then just make that shape. So one of my stucks seems to look like this today. Okay, so everybody find one. All right, now, stuck is not sustainable. There is nothing in life that's sustainable. Stuck wants to move. It wants to change and shift. But oftentimes what we think is what keeps us from actually contacting a deeper kind of energy for change. So here's your stuck. I'm going to ask you to stay with this. Stay with it. So commit to this. This is it. This is my shape. It's a sculpture. It's just a... So feel it. What do the legs feel like and the hands and the jaw? Where are you looking? Okay, get in the body shape. Now, if this shape could say something, if it had a word or a couple of words, what would it say? Just say it to yourself. Okay, now stay with it. Don't think about where you want it to go. Don't think about it at all. Where does the body want to move to? Right, just like we practiced earlier. Where do the shoulders want to go? Now just begin very slowly. Where does it, what does the body want to do now? And now, stay with the body, the feeling, above the body, now. Now, don't think about where you want to go. Just follow the body. Follow the body. Stay with it. Let your mindfulness stay with it until you get into sculpture two. Okay? Once you get into sculpture two, again, I want you to say a word or a few words as though this sculpture had something to say. What is that? Okay, good. Now rest. Perfect. Now, all right. Did you have it that far? So now let's see. Gio, do you mind doing your sculpture one to sculpture two? And then let us reflect back. Is that, will that work? Good.
Yes, that could work.
Okay. So, Gio, you start and we'll reflect back. So you can do this, those of us that are watching, you can just do it by yourself with, as I said, with saying sculpture one has words, it moves to sculpture two, it has words. Or if you have a couple of friends, you can ask them to reflect back. So we're going to look at Gio's. Let's see, sculpture one. And when he gets into a sculpture too, he's going to say a word or a little phrase.
Feeling supported by those around me.
Beautiful. So I'm going to reflect back a little bit about what I saw. And again, it's my experience. It's not Gio's. I don't know Gio's experience. I'm talking about what it was that I experienced when I was a witness and holding space for him and just letting my own insight arise. So my insight was that I saw something being held close to something being offered. That's what I'm reflecting that back of what I saw and felt. Do we have another reflection, Lewis?
Yes. I saw closeness, like it felt nurturing, but maybe a little vulnerable to kind of letting go, kind of releasing that tightness and just feeling more grounded.
Thank you. So then, Gio, you have a little bit of an opportunity to reflect on not only your experience in words, but a little bit of reflection back in terms of maybe there's something that you, that we see and we feel that can be insightful for you. So that's the method. And so do either you or anyone else have something you would like to say about that or your own, those of you that were have joined us, your own movement from sculpture one to sculpture two, anything that you noticed about that or that you saw or felt or that interested you? Thank you so much. The two of you for your careful attention and positive regard that you have. Anything that anyone would like to share in the last minute here?
I noticed a strong sense of like disconnect at the beginning. I felt really disconnected from my body. And as I moved to my sculpture too, I felt not necessarily a resolution to the disconnect, but almost trying to like build a shield around that and protect myself from it.
Thank you.
Kathy shares that from sculpture one to sculpture two, it was a surprising direction that happened and was curious where it would go next.
Mm-hmm. Beautiful. I'm often surprised with mine also.
From sculpture one, it came from being really weighed down and tired, not really wanting to be on my legs, to going towards like a runner position, like feeling a less weight on my shoulders, wanting to kind of jump into something, you know?
Mm. Beautiful. Do we have one more?
Allison shares that she saw her hands were in a collapsed way, almost a beg or pleading. So it's very powerful to notice that and then release it and say open.
Mm. Beautiful. Thank you so much. I hope this is just gives you a little bit of a sense of what the work is that Heather's been doing with her students and that they're sharing in such a generous and kind of helpful way with on the campus with others. And they recently, Gio and Heather recently shared on a large Presencing Institute gathering of 1,000 people, they shared this story of what their work is. So it's such a generous kind of offering, and we so appreciate this time together. I wanted to invite Uri, who's one of our colleagues and does just remarkable work in healing and with a variety of different methods, one of which is social presencing theater. And we would very much like to invite him to join us now and to share his insights and stories.
It's really great to be here today. I want to share a little part of my story of arriving to social presence in theater and meeting Arowana, and then connecting it with the work I've experienced and hearing about happening by this wonderful group. So I was born in Israel in a small village in the Galilee. I came to theater quite unexpectedly, maybe subconsciously, through a process of actually seeking healing without knowing it. Following my experience in the army, and theater have found me, and I found theater as a sort of a way to process experience that I've lived through, and also the experience of others. And first I met in the university classical theater, let's say, or the classical approach to what is theater. And through those studies, I came across theater of the oppressed, which became an important part of my life and a community that I feel proud to be exploring with, which looks at theater as a way to empower oneself and others' communities and give voice to unheard stories. And in that process of trying to figure out what that means and how to do that, I came across Theory U and social presence in theater. And in 2015, I went to do a basic training with Arowana in Berlin. And I remember we were doing a field dance, which is one of those practices we did, which was basically crossing the space, the stage space, and being in front of the group. And Arowana was saying a little bit like what she did now, asking us to kind of feel the back and feel our support of our ancestors and teachers. And what happened to me from there is that I felt my grandmother, my paternal grandmother, who was born and grew up in Berlin, there with me. And so for me, social presence in theater somehow is connected with Berlin. I always go to, I did my basic and then I did my advanced in Berlin, and also the research summer school where I met Heather. And it's almost like the journey of meeting social presence in theater is connected with meeting my story and my ancestor story, in particularly the ones in Berlin, but also indirectly with others. And it might take a bit longer to tell the whole story, but I can share that it has several visions, moments, and things that are hard to explain in words. Also a ritual space we held inspired by work that reconnects in social presence in theater. And I saw before some people in the attendance list that have been in that ritual from my advanced cohort in Berlin and my mother and other people's. And I just wanted to share that something happened to me in the last model of the advanced training. I was walking and processing, and I think I realized that I'm both German and Jewish, and I have both. And I realized that I have to, and that the German part was kind of pressed down inside. It was kind of crunchy, and it was not allowing me to be straight. And I have to forgive it and let it be. And what happened next is that I started to feel energy going through my spine for about 24 hours. I then read about it in the internet because it was kind of alarming. Apparently, some people consider it a Kundalini awakening or something like that sort. I never heard about it before. And it was very powerful. And to connect with that is I think my work and research with theater, social arts has been in a way very personal, but also I hope very universal, because in the end, we're all who we are, but also we're everything else. And then the theater of the oppressed, I felt, gave me a lot of vision into social systems from looking out, looking at the social context and oppression. But social presence theater just allowed me to look in and to see how that has an entire possibility and realms of possibilities. I really feel blessed and happy to be here today and share a little bit with you. And I met Heather in Berlin as well in the first social field summer school. And the words that and the way, the energy that came from her words of working with this group and the presentation and the meetings that I had with you made me feel that the work that I can intuit that is possible is already being done, and you're doing it. So I'm very happy and looking forward to hear more and see more of this work developing. So yeah, and I want to invite Joe to share more.
Hi, thank you so much, Udi, for sharing all of those experiences. Something that I'd like to talk about now, like Udi was mentioning, was these possibilities. And I think some of those possibilities are what our group is doing, and actually using SPT for application. So specifically our group, I practice with a group of people at SPT, at Queensborough Community College. You've seen many of them today throughout the practices, like Felicia and Lewis and Chris and Justin and Gio and Jess. And we work as a group to do a lot of different things. And one of the main applications of SPT that we use for is to have these conversations that include, but are definitely not limited to, responding to pieces of art, creating our own pieces of art. In December of 2019, we were able to create a showing based on of application of SPT. And I think the main focus is creating change within our community. And we want to decolonize the place of the classroom and formal education and create a place where the student themselves is centered in their own education and has an authority over their own education. And doing that through letting the students speak for what they believe. And then something like empathy to action that might seem very complicated, but at a base level, it's really simple of just being able to communicate with each other and empathize. And that's where change can come from. And not just from the top down, but including every person, every member of the community, including the lowest part of the community where the struggle typically happens, to the people who are usually of authority and power, and then the system itself. So we also wanted to demonstrate one of our applications by responding to the Kupferberg Holocaust Center's exhibit Survivors, that is titled Survivors and Sovereignty on Turtle Island, Engaging with Contemporary Native American Art, that was curated by Danielle Means and Kat Griffin. We had the fortune of going to this exhibit and we responded so strongly to it. Seeing the artwork created in response to genocide and displacement really moved us, and we wanted to share with you all some of the responses that we had. So one of the first pieces that we're going to respond to today is called Shrouded in Gray. For anybody who wants to see more on the pieces that we'll be responding to, there'll be a slide later on that includes all of the artworks and titles in the exhibit. So we could just have that slide, yeah. And I'd also like to invite one of our participants, Christopher Harris, who's going to work through using the practice we talked about earlier, Stuck, and kind of the journey of growing and building. So in response to these art pieces, we're going to take a moment to just kind of observe the art and see if there's anything in particular that we respond to. So if Chris, if you want to just take a moment to just start practicing. And we'll see Chris take a moment to just observe what it is that he's seeing and feel the gesture from the art piece that speaks to him to create his first sculpture. And we'll see his body start to sense what he was feeling and start to shift. And as we see him shifting, we should also acknowledge just the fact that, like, there are no one way to do these practices. So I'd also like to invite Lewis and Gio to also join, just so we can see that there's a multiplicity to these practices. There's no right or wrong way to create them. The conversation is individual between you and the art piece. And we can see each of them moving through their own way, their conversation, the journey that they're going on in response to this art. And this isn't performance, it's a way for them to communicate back and forth and feel what they're feeling when they see the artwork. Okay, and we're just gonna take a moment to just find our last shape and hold that shape. Like Arowana was explaining earlier, it's very important to explore that space between movement and stillness and resonate and feel what the shape feels like that we're in. And then also take time for reflection. So from that shape, Lewis, would you like to offer some reflection?
Yeah. I'm realizing, or I'm feeling, that my eyes are open to the water. I remember in the picture I saw the word religion amongst all the other words, and that really kind of synchronizes with gratitude.
Lewis, if you could just repeat some of that, it's kind of difficult to hear. You can drop the pose if you need to for audio purposes.
Sorry. Yes.
No, it's okay.
I was feeling, I saw that my eyes were going up, and I also remember not looking at the image. And I saw the word religion, and that really synced in with my current situation. So I'll be able to connect that word. I also realized I was feeling a lot of gratitude and comfort coming within. Like, I felt a little wobbly from the beginning, but I started to kind of change myself and renewal in it.
Thank you so much, Lewis. Gio, would you like to take a moment to just reflect about your journey?
Of course. As the last shape that I have here, it's kind of similar to what my first shape was, or what I felt. I felt like something delicate, but not knowing how to preserve it. And so my body went through a journey of trying to acknowledge every word, every shape that is here, and to really how that basket, kind of how do I respond to it, and if there's another way of holding that delicacy, holding that importance, information, and all that it contains. So then I kind of gently and without thinking figure out a way of just holding this delicacy in a different way that's not just at the beginning that perhaps I was lost, but also now I feel a little more centered and grounded that I can not only just hold this delicacy, but also hold my delicacy and support it as well.
Yeah. That's really beautiful. Thank you so much, Lewis and Gio. Like we saw, there's so many different ways to respond to these things. And through the confines of home, creating this at home can be difficult. Chris, would you like to just speak about your reflection on your response to this sculpture?
Yes. I'm kind of seeing it now as the basket. It was kind of, for me, it was like kind of picturing myself inside the basket in some way. That's why it had the walls and me turning to realize I am covered on all ends. Mm-hmm. And that kind of brought me to really kind of basking in that space and thinking about how it feels to be and then realizing that the only way out is up, which kind of like now, if you're feeling kind of low and you're on that ground level, they always say the only way to go is up. So that was kind of my whole journey in my mind.
Thank you, Chris. That's amazing. And as we can see on the current slide, Chris also chose to respond to the art piece by creating a separate piece of art. He actually wrote this poem in response to the specific zoomed in image of the basket. Chris, if you'd like, could you share your poem with us?
Sure. What do you see when you look at this picture? A pattern, history. The truth is covered in black. A distraction, a pleasant, appealing distraction. But look closely, and if you don't see it, look closer. The words of evil, true evil, genocide, a plan, evicted, disrupt. History, these are words of our history. This pattern is the pattern, a pattern repeated. How evil triumphs and remains on top. They've distracted us for years. Our attention is put on each other, against each other, disrupted. We can't see past what we've been told. Somehow it always comes out in anger. Their plan is put into play. The plan is to distract while disrupt. Evict those that stand, evict those from this land. Their land, how? Genocide. How many died? Paint the truth in black and distract. It's in their nature. No, not this time. We've looked close to see the lie, we know. The truth is covered in lies. There's a fog, the words painted in black. But in all their precision, they put themselves in a trap. This pattern, we've seen it before, and it is what it is by definition. We know the rhythm, the rhyme scheme. We rise against it. We marched for the better, to do better, be better than the lies they make us out to be.
Thank you so much, Chris, for sharing that. Could you talk a little bit about the process of creating something like this and the transformation that you've gone through from the start of your journey with SPT?
Well, for the poem, using the zoomed out image, and I guess it kind of took a moment, like in the beginning where we take a moment and meditate on on our feet being on the floor. It took me a moment to really like look at this picture and realize that the patterns that are in the basket, the white parts are like newspaper clippings of events that were taking place in history. And it took only another moment to be like, this is relevant to now. This is relevant to then. This is relevant to so many different people who've suffered throughout their lives, like living in this land. Like, this is the history of America, where the process to now is like, it's not all that great. So that's what, and from there, the words kind of just played out as I've written it. And as to my journey with SPT, it really does give you a place to really have moments like this, have an epiphany for yourself, spiritually, mentally, emotionally. And it gives you that time to really be like, this is okay with the group of people that are here. Like, it's okay to feel and be right here for this moment, in this moment, and even beyond, if we give ourselves the time.
Thank you so much, Chris. Thank you for sharing the poem with us. That was really amazing. And like Chris was speaking to, and earlier Jess and Udi also mentioned this, there, when we take the time to listen to our bodies, there's this ancestral connection to the earth, to the people that came before us. And SPT oftentimes allows us to access that space. We do this a lot, and we are able to have these conversations to access these places of empathy and this connection to our ancestral spaces that are in a low stakes setting. So it allows us to explore these conversations that maybe we wouldn't necessarily feel comfortable speaking to in other methods. So what we're going to do now is just shift to show another way that we can create some artwork in response using SPT. So Lewis also created a response that is more performance-based, which isn't always necessarily the reason why we use SPT, but this is her reflection and the way that she wants to manifest that reflection. So we can play that video.
Dear whoever's listening, why is bad a thing? Why do bad things happen all the time? The news reeks of it. It's never believable to hear, but it's there. Spamming the air, distorting our line of reasoning, hope falls into despair. And it's like no one cares. So, why is bad there? In light of the bad is just that, the light. Beauty that stays hungry to awaken. It always leaves the mind breathtaking. It's the thought of hope is still chasing after me as I drive down the street. Like I'm worthy to be. amongst the flowers and the trees, the birds and the bees, connecting to the rocks below and above my feet, talking to you and changing me for a better me tomorrow.
Thank you so much, Lewis, for that offering. Would you like to share some reflection about the process and seeing the video once it was completed?
Yes, yeah, I'd love to. It's always funny watching myself because I always feel like when I see myself on the screen, I'm just gonna have so much anxiety and probably gonna implode on myself just sitting here thinking about like, me do things and just move around, but I try to actually stay calm and breathe and feel into my body this time and not just let anxiety take over, because at the end of the day, when I look into the mirror, I see myself, but when I go away from that mirror, I never get to actually look at me and take myself in, and to actually have the ability to just look at myself move and feel within and not have to think twice about my emotions or what's going to happen after the video. No, I was literally in the moment, and I don't do that enough. You know, you don't take in moments like that. You don't really reflect back to, like, you don't reflect into the things that you're doing sometimes, and to be able to kind of feel in and not just worry about who I am on this world and just live and breathe.
Thank you so much, Lewis. That was amazing. And then we're also now going to transition to Gio, also created a video. And just also want to keep in mind, these videos were created from home. So there's no right or wrong way to do this. It doesn't need to be practiced in a studio or in a theater. It can be practiced at home. It can be practiced by yourself. It can be practiced through Zoom. And now we're going to share Gio's video of what he created.
I feel grateful for what's around me, for who's around me, and for the shared space with nature, with animals, and with fellow humans, to consume and preserve this space. Space of Earth.
Thank you, Gio, for sharing that video. As we can see, Gio used a more direct approach of using the actual practice to respond to the artwork. can you talk to what it was like to create that, especially from the confines of like doing it at home as opposed to our traditional setting of doing it in the theater?
Yes, first of all, thank you all for sharing my piece with you all. I really resonated with this piece, and the first thing that came up to mind was one of the practices that we use in SPT, which is stuck. And so I know that as I'm right here in my little corner of my room, I know that there was some call of action response, but I didn't quite fully know how to until I just saw the exhibit and really took in, and without thinking, stuck came up to me. And noticing how my space was around me, it wasn't an issue at all. It actually helped because this is one of the practices that we could do within ourselves and with the limited spaces that we have. And so the exhibit really resonated with me, as my first thought was the things that how we use nature and how we use other people within nature, other groups that we all hold value, but yet we're not really given that value. We're not really being heard from nature to communities. And so that was my first stuck, the trying to understand why this value wasn't really being offered to the earth or to myself or to other communities. And so as I was moving and shifting to my sculpture too, I was then really impacted by nature, and my body was really taking in the offerings of what nature gave, from the animals to the water to the sky. And it really, for me, it gave me so much gratitude to have this shared space, the piece of nature that we have, and to the communities that I share and I live next to. And that second sculpture was more honoring that space, honoring the nature and the communities, and also myself, to also give permission and say to myself that I also have value. Just like our communities and our ancestors before us. And so this kind of liberating sculpture, this liberating kind of felt like a liberating experience, in which by giving others value, I gave, and nature as well, value, I gave myself, and we were all like pillars, kind of in support of each other, and kind of living in the shared space. So, yeah, thank you.
Thank you, Gio. That was amazing. So we're gonna now move on to our last part. And just an offer of reflection, we see here with these students that they created all of these different pieces, which just shows further the importance of allowing students to center themselves in their own education, in the center of their own creation and creative minds. All of them created these individual pieces that expressed themselves, that were authentic and genuine, and also improvised. There was no prompts for these. They were just their pure, genuine responses, which just further shows that allowing ourselves to be authentic and create can really move people and create change and provide a sense of community and belonging that I think, especially in the time of a pandemic, especially in the time of feeling a lot of loneliness and being trapped at home, is super important and allows for these people like our group here to come together to create something like this. And now I'd like to pass it back to Udi, who is gonna offer some reflection on the workshop today.
I was very moved and thankful. And again, I feel those works show us so much of what is possible, both in terms of theater in this very confined, weird world we're living in today, but in terms of this connection of the deeply personal, deeply universal, and art as a gateway into deep research of social, political, and spiritual significance somehow. yeah, just humbled and thankful for the work that is being carried out. Maybe I'll just offer a gesture of bring to heart. And Arwana as well, if she wants to join in.
Uri, I just completely echo and resonate with what you have said. This, the beauty and power of what has been done by all of you from the school today is really, it's just stunning, really. And so I feel so humbled and grateful for what you've all offered and for Heather's work in guiding and hosting and training all of us in this art form, which, as Uri said so beautifully, links the deeply personal with the systemic, with the kind of bigger view of global and spiritual world that we all live in. And these moments, just moments, gestures, the words of these poems, they open from the most minute and moment of the heart of the individual person up into the real sense of like global humanity, and then beyond that. So I'm so appreciative of Heather and all of you, and of course Laura for hosting this. So, and I turn it over now to Heather.
Hi, you all. Thank you so much, everyone who's still here with us. Thanks to Arwana. Thanks to Uri. Thank you to Laura for allowing us to have this space to share. It's been really special for us, and we're just delighted. Jess is going to come up now, and just we have a few things that we wanted to let you know, just messages of appreciation, and also ways that you could connect with us if you're interested in exploring.
Thank you, Heather. I'd also like to take a moment to say thank you to the many supporters who have made this event possible. Thank you, Laura, Victoria, and Marissa from the Kupferberg Holocaust Center. Thank you, Betty from the Global Citizenship Alliance. Thank you, Christina and Khan from CUNY Transformative Learning in the Humanities. Thank you, Arwana, Uri, and Manish. Also, thank you to Aviva for her support. And thank you to Heather Huggins and all of our participants today. I'd also like to thank the artists and curators, Danielle and also Kat, of Survivance and Sovereignty on Turtle Island, engaging with contemporary Native American art. And lastly, I would like to thank you all for joining us today and hope you can join us again at our upcoming events. The next being Friday, April 16th at 10:15 a.m., cultivating communities of care through action research as a part of the Faculty Diversity and Inclusion Conference. And then Saturday, April 24th at 10:30 a.m., Peacebuilding through Awareness and Improvisation Part 2, where we will be experiencing SPT as awareness-based systems change. Now I would like to invite Laura back for our final words of the day.
Hi, everyone. This has been really powerful today, and I'm sitting here with a lot of tears. I feel like I might just like burst out crying, and I think that's because so much of the work we do at the Kupferberg Holocaust Center is about remembering the past, and often that past is filled with horror and pain, and this work today reminds me, as well as the tremendous work that Kat Griffin and Danielle Means and all the artists did and all the students and faculty members who participated in the Survivance and Sovereignty on Turtle Island exhibition and all of our programming at the KHC is really about life and is making these connections between the past even more resonant in the future, and talking about what it means to not only live with these memories, but to put them into conversation and to really harness the power of peace building and relationship. So I want to thank all of you for attending today. We're so grateful. Stay safe.